start by saying thank you all for being here. And I'd like to go in at the beginning to exactly what happened in the elections for the State Duma on December the 4th. United Russia, which is the party of government, went into the elections having won 64% of the vote 4 years earlier and with a two-thirds majority in the Duma, which allowed them to change certain articles of the Constitution, not all articles, but some of them. After the vote on December the 4th, they had lost 77 seats. Their 64% support had fallen to 49%. Now, that's, by any standards, is a very significant loss of support. Yeah. I have been actually at every election in Russia since the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991, either as a journalist or an international observer. And there have been irregularities, notably a strong media bias towards the government party, not only in the Putin era, but in the Yeltsin era. One will remember that in the presidential election in 1996, that President Putin, who was standing for re-election, had a major heart attack in the last couple of weeks before the poll, and this was not reported in any of the newspapers or on any of the television stations. So there was a media bias then, and it continued later into the Putin era. But the general conduct of the elections, you know, on polling day, the organisation of the voting and the counts, were, as usually, they were quite good. This time, however, for the first time, the observers from ODIHR, that's the Office for Democratic and Institutions, Democratic Institutions and Human Rights of the OSCE, they were strongly critical of the way the actual voting and the count was done. And that is very unusual, because the ODIHR usually phrases their complaints in an extremely diplomatic way. They were far more outspoken than usual this time. So in December, in any event, the Communist Party was second, as usual, but they had a significant increase in their vote and in their representation in the Duma. But even the unwavering support of Vladimir Zhirinovsky's so-called Liberal Democratic Party still left United Russia 6 votes short of a two-thirds majority if the United Russia and the Liberal Democrats voted together, as they always do. So there's no intention, I understand, of changing the constitution, but it is a power that has been taken away from the ruling parties in Russia. So United Russia ended up with 49.3% of the vote and 52% of the seats. Their representation fell from 315 seats in the Duma to 238. The Communist Party rose from up to 19% of the vote, with a Just Russia on 13% and the Liberal Democrats on 11.6%. Now, the reason why United Russia got 52% of the seats with 49.3% in a list system is that three other parties, Yabloko, Patriots of Russia, and Right Cause, failed to reach the 7% necessary for representation, and their percentages of votes were therefore redistributed to the four parties who actually did get more than 7%. So United Russia went up from 49 to 52%. So the OSCE ODIHR report was quite critical. And I'd like to explain exactly what the ODIHR observers do. I've been both a long-term and short-term observer for that organisation in the past, short-term only in Russia, but a long-term elsewhere. Their methodology is exceptionally strict. First of all, a core team is set up with legal experts, media experts, etc. They arrive first, then the long-term observers arrive, and the duties of the long-term observer are not only to be involved in how the count, etc., took place, but they studied the media to see if there's any bias in the media towards the government. They have a look at the situation regarding state institutions and see if they are using their authority to help one party over another, etc. And usually they're there for about a month before the elections take place. Then the short-term observers arrive a few days before the elections. They have a look around, they do a recce of the area of responsibility that they're given. They go to the polling stations and introduce themselves. They maybe have 10 or 15 polling stations in their area of responsibility. But in Russia, for example, there are 95,000 polling stations. And the count takes place in each polling station. So there are 95,000 counts. So it's ever impossible for ODIHR, OSCE, to get a really representative sample. The situation is that of the 15 stations, etc., in the area of responsibility of a short-term observer, usually teams of two, one male, one female, from different countries, they go then to the polling station, which they've decided themselves at the last moment where they will observe a count. So the polling station, which is chosen, doesn't know in advance where they're going to go. They watch the count. They see the votes being counted. The situation that happens then is that the result of that count in the polling station is written on what's called a protocol. And that's sent to the central headquarters. The result is sent on this protocol. Now, one of the serious criticisms made by ODIHR this time was that there appeared to be problems with the observers seeing this protocol before it was sent to the central area to be transmitted to Moscow and tabulated. So a large number of observers or polling stations at which observers attended did not allow the observers to see this protocol. So they couldn't know whether the votes that they saw being counted were entered correctly on the protocol. That's a pretty serious thing. Another point is that in their final report, which was actually just issued a couple of days ago, ODIHR say that during the campaign, the distinction between the state and the governing party was frequently blurred by state and local officials taking advantage of their office or position to advance the chances of one party over the others. This is ODIHR being quite diplomatic again. They're not saying which party. However, they believe that this was taking place. They also talk about instances of vote stuffing, ballot box stuffing. In one of the polling stations that I visited in Moscow on polling day. It was polling station number 174 in Ulica Timura Frunze. And if there is one organization that can observe at all polling, 95,000 polling stations in Russia, it is the Communist Party, because they have members everywhere. And the Communist Party in that station brought to my attention that there were roughly 200 votes cast in one of the ballot boxes before the station had opened for polling that morning, and that it appeared that all 200 had been cast for United Russia. There are also in hospitals where a mobile box can be brought out for people to vote who are indisposed and unable to attend the actual polling station itself. There were cases in which ballot papers were delivered to patients in hospitals already marked for United Russia. So there were, it would appear, more irregularities than in previous elections. But were those irregularities enough to ensure that United Russia would get the seats that they did? Were United Russia actually going to lose their majority? It's very hard to know. ODIHR does not say anything about whether the election was even free or fair. It stays by its role, which is just to observe the elections and report what they have seen. They don't go into opinions. Now, there have been some reports of, particularly in Moscow, of really serious irregularities which may have actually influenced the result of the entire election. I'm not absolutely sure how true these reports are. One report quotes an exit poll in the Moscow city area, which showed that only 27% voted for United Russia, whereas the official result shows that 46% voted for United Russia. But even the organizers of that poll withdrew it themselves because they felt that their methodology wasn't up to scratch. However, there were, grounds for worrying about the result in Moscow, because the Moscow region, the oblast, voted only in the 30s for United Russia. And Moscow City is usually more strongly anti-government than the region. And here they are voting 46%. So that is quite interesting. But the 95,000, the only organization which can actually observe in 95,000 polling stations, the Communist Party, has been extremely quiet about this. There is a suggestion that they know that they're not going probably ever to win an election, and that they're quite happy being in second place. And they, with almost 20% this time, would be quite happy with 91 seats in the Duma. But they were the beneficiaries of a protest vote, because the other two parties which gained representation, that's Zhirinovsky's right-wing self-styled Liberal Democratic Party and a just Russia are subject of suspicion by the electorate. Zhirinovsky has never voted against the government. He has spoken against it in campaigns, etc. Once it comes to the crunch of a vote in the Duma, his party always votes with United Russia. A just Russia had associations with the Kremlin before the election. So people were suspicious of them as well. Therefore, the only party that really appeared to oppose the government was the Communist Party. So there was, they gained a protest vote, and they also gained an additional protest vote, in my view, because the traditional box at the bottom of the Russian ballot paper, protiv vsekh, against everyone, I vote against all the above, was not on the ballot paper this time. So if a person wanted to vote against, strongly against the government, they voted for the Communist Party. And anecdotally, people that I know in Russia, it was quite interesting, families that I know, that it was the older generation, people who had, many of them had been part of the Soviet apparatus, had been members of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, they voted for United Russia. Their offspring were more likely to vote for the Communist Party. So they, in my view, were voting for the party of power, which was the party that they had always been associated with. The result of the election, as you know, was followed by very serious demonstrations. There were small demonstrations immediately after the result in the center of Moscow, usually by radical groups who try to get themselves arrested, etc. But there were two other very, very big and very serious demonstrations by an organization which went through all the rules, applied to the local government for permission to hold its demonstrations and held them within the law. The first one was on Bolotnaya Plushad, which is just across the river from the Kremlin. There were between 30 and 50,000 people at that one. Then on our Christmas Eve, which is 24th of December, which is just an ordinary day in Russia, there was this big demo on Academika Sakharova, which is in the north of Moscow. I know it very well. I used to live around the corner. But the police said there were 29,000 there, and the organizers estimated there were 120,000. So it was a very big gap. But it was certainly more than 29,000, considerably more. Moscow Times people estimated perhaps 80,000. Now, who attended these demonstrations? There's quite an interesting situation here in that the organizers of the demonstrations commissioned the Levada Center, which is the most reputable polling agency in Russia. The demonstrations organizers commissioned Levada to do a poll of the demonstrators. So it's fairly accurate what we know who these people are. I'm sure other people know who they are as well, but there were 60% male and 40% female. 80% were under 55. 62% had a third-level education. A further 8% had two or more university degrees. So there's 70%. So you're looking at a highly educated group. You're looking basically at the new Russian middle class and the new Moscow middle class in particular, because the demonstrations in other cities didn't reach anything like these numbers. You're also looking at a very disparate group. The Levada Center poll asked people whether who they would vote for if there was an election next Sunday. 22% said that they would vote for Alexei Navalny, who is an anti-corruption blogger and comes from the very right wing of Russian politics. 21% said they would vote for Grigory Yavlinsky, who is probably the closest Russian politician to a sort of Western-style liberal. So here you've got two poles of the Russian population, one for Navalny and one for Yavlinsky. Will they be able to hold together in an election, you know, with, if there was they decided to have a united candidate, would the liberals shy away from voting for Navalny, or would the right-wingers shy away from voting for Yavlinsky? It's for that, that's one of the reasons why I feel myself that Prime Minister Putin will win the election in March. And Levada's poll on that puts him on 42%, with the others nowhere, basically. Gennady Zhuganov, who is the head of the Communist Party, on 9%, and Zhirinovsky also on 9%. There's also another candidate who has emerged, Prokhorov, who is a very wealthy oligarch who made his money in precious metals. He, as I've written, stands out in a crowd because he happens to be 6'8". And that's probably why he, instead of buying a soccer team in England, bought the New Jersey Nets basketball team in the United States, where you can look the players in the eye. however, he has had associations with the government, with the Kremlin, had a bit of a row with them, but he's back again, and I'm not sure, I don't think he will do well at all, because, first of all, the vast majority of Russian voters absolutely despise the oligarchs. They regard them as the ones who have stolen the money from the people. He also has had associations with the Kremlin, as I've said, and there is a suspicion that he may be a sort of a plant who's put there to sweep up some liberal votes without being a threat to the candidature of Prime Minister Putin. That has been reinforced by the fact that recently he has been given a lot of airtime on NTV, which is a television station owned by Gazprom, and which supports the government absolutely to the core. So I think he can also be ruled out. But I think we should also look not only at the poll where it gives an idea of who the protesters are. We should look as well at particularly those who are leading the protests. Navalny is a blogger, and the internet has become exceptionally important because television and the mass media in general, one or two exceptions, such as Novaya Gazeta, this a small circulation newspaper, and the radio Echo Moskvy, which has quite a large listenership. But apart from those, TV in general is under the control of the government. So the opposition has moved into the internet in a big way. Navalny coined this phrase, Partia Zhulikov I Vorov, the party of crooks and thieves, for United Russia. That has stuck. People on the street, when they're referring to the party, they say Partia Zhulikov I Vorov. They don't say Yedinaya Rossiya. Navalny says himself that, you know, it has stuck, not because of me, it has stuck because it's true. However, he has been very strong pointing out incidences of corruption. He's done so on the internet, and he's done it with humour, with a certain amount of skill, and has become an exceptionally popular figure. He's young, in his mid-30s, a real estate lawyer. He has had a fellowship in Yale. But there's a dark side to Navalny. He has associated himself with extreme right-wing groups, the skinheads, the racists, has put forward certain ideas, which he may have picked up when he was in Yale, that every Russian has the right to bear arms and have a pistol. He has put certain things up on YouTube. For example, in one of them, he compares people from the Northern Caucasus with cockroaches, with the tarakan, and shows that you can kill a tarakan with a fly swat or with your slipper. But then a number of tough-looking guys in sort of Muslim gear arrive on the scene, on the picture, and he says, in this case, I would advise a pistol. So this is the sort of person who has given himself prominence through the internet. And I would argue that this is also because that the famous managed democracy has failed, and it has caused this sort of thing. As on the one hand, the management of the Duma has placed the communists in the position where they are regarded as the only real opposition to United Russia. The management of the mass media in support of Prime Minister Putin has forced the street opposition onto the internet, and they are exceptionally good at it. There's a bar in Moscow called Masterskaya, which is almost in the shadow of the headquarters of the FSB, the Lubyanka, where these people meet. You have actual television producers from state TV who, when they finish their job promoting the government on television under orders, come to Masterskaya and discuss how they are going to produce anti-government material on the internet. And I have some of it here, which I'd like you to see. I'm not saying that I agree with this, but I think it would give you an idea of what is going on. First of all, the decision by United Russia at its conference in Luzhniki in September that President Medvedev would resign from the presidency and support the candidature of Prime Minister Putin was something that really annoyed Russians. There were people who felt that Medvedev had a different program, etc. But this conference, in which they admitted that the decision was made 4 years ago, showed these Russians that Medvedev was really a man of straw. Now, this first video shows clips from the party conference interspersed with clips from the movie Titanic. You have an announcement from Medvedev that he supports Putin, and you see the Titanic immediately crashing into the iceberg. Then you have Putin saying that Dmitry Medvedev will now run United Russia instead of being president, and you have a clip from the Titanic of one of the sailors shooting himself in the head and falling into the sea. I know there are Russian speakers here, so they'll understand more of it, but I don't want to also either to interrupt this particular video. Go ahead. Thanks, Linda.
Об этом напечатали в газетах.
Every night in Biden, Sassio.
Договоренность о том, что делать, чем заниматься в будущем, между нами давно достигнута. Это ведь уникальный случай в российской политике. Далеко не все партии к этому готовы. И положительный эффект виден сегодня. Очень приятно. Я считаю, что было бы правильно, чтобы съезд поддержал кандидатуру председателя партии Владимира Путина на должность президента страны. Предлагаю, чтобы список «Единой России» на выборах в Государственную Думу возглавил действующий глава государства Дмитрий Анатольевич Медведев. Это, безусловно, ответственное и очень серьезное предложение.
Я не уйду, не убедившись, что у тебя все хорошо.
Если крысы бегут, я последую их примеру.
Мы действительно обсуждали этот вариант развития событий еще в тот период, когда сформировался наш союз.
Господи Иисусе!
Огромное спасибо гражданам России за понимание и поддержку. Спасибо за поддержку.
Buy a ticket on another ship, says, and sail away on the 4th of December. So that was as part of a campaign on the internet in the election era. There's another one which is considerably more sinister, which is a sort of a 1984 theme. In which it's claimed that Putin and Medvedev are turning the Russian people into zombies. Oh, let's turn the television into a zombie. Yeah. Here we are, yeah.
Жить по шаблону — это завоевание современности. каком политическом состоянии находится страна? Она спокойная, уравновешенная, стабильная.
Принимать дозу препарата. Принимать дозу препарата. Принимать дозу препарата. Принимать дозу препарата.
Просто потому, что у нас иначе никакой страны не будет. Либо она вот есть такая, как сегодня, либо у нас не будет никакой России.
Что-то потребуется подкорректировать, это тоже можно сделать. Я во всяком случае считаю, что все средства хороши.
Change all this on the 4th of December. But more traditionally, those opposed to power in Russia have used humor. And the sense of humor has been a great weapon in Russia. So I have two more very short videos to show you. One is made by a group in Novosibirsk, and it basically gives the New Year's wishes. It shows the Brezhnev's New Year's wishes on television, and Gorbachev's and Putin's. And it points out that they're all the same. And then, at the very last minute, there's a very pointed reference to Medvedev, which this video claims is a man of straw. So, I don't know if Linda can manage it this time as well.
Дорогие соотечественники.
Дорогие товарищи.
Товарищи. И друзья.
Дорогие друзья.
Идут последние минуты.
Истекают последние минуты.
Через несколько минут наступит самый любимый, теплый.
Всенародный праздник в нашей стране.
Мы уже увереннее смотрим в будущее.
С надеждой смотрим в будущее.
Пусть в новом году. Пусть Новый год будет
самым плодотворным периодом
в развитии экономики.
Экономики.
Сейчас кремлевские куранты возвестят о наступлении Нового года.
Сейчас у телевизоров.
Сейчас за праздничным столом.
В ожидании звона кремлевских курантов собрались
друзья, самые родные и близкие люди.
Луноход один.
Пусть будут здоровья и благополучия,
радость и счастье
в каждой семье нашей большой
страны.
Счастья вам.
Счастья вам.
С новым счастьем.
С новым годом. Дорогие соотечественники.
Дорогие товарищи.
Мира и благополучия.
Удачи.
Спасибо.
And finally, this one is only 13 seconds, but it's probably the funniest one and perhaps the most damaging to Prime Minister Putin, who is not keen on being portrayed in a humorous way. So you want to watch this very carefully because it's over very quickly. This is the race for the presidency of Russia. Well, what I wanted to show here is how professional these demonstrators and their leaders are, and how effective they have been on the internet. They are now worried, of course, that there will be restrictions placed on the internet. I don't think that there will, but what I think may happen is that the United Russia and their supporters will try to dominate the internet with their own expertise, which they undoubtedly have. Perhaps they may even have the television producers who work for them during the daytime and against them at nighttime, they might have them involved. It's very hard to know. However, excuse me, that's what they are doing, and there are others. There are others which show them actually in a worse way than these. Some of them are quite really objectionable. Navalny himself says that I wouldn't use his words, but his words are that there will be a plan to suppress protest. It would probably take two tried and tested forms. One, attempts to restrict by law the means of disseminating information on the internet by passing anti-extremist legislation and so on. Or two, as he puts it, the allocation of more suitcases full of money for the creation of a pro-Kremlin internet with its own moulders of public opinion, chosen from amongst well-known figures in Putin's media retinue. He's probably closer to the mark on his second possibility. But there is no doubt that the reason why Navalny particularly has grabbed so much attention in Russia is that there is corruption in Russia. There always has been, as I say, anyone who has been to the Abbey Theatre to watch the government inspector recently, or who has read Gogol's Dead Souls, where Sobakevich says, there's only one honest man in this town, the prosecutor, and he's a swine. So this has been going on for a long time, but it has reached a level which has made Russians worried. You know, even people, like, for example, I interviewed the mother of one of the three young men who was killed on the second night of the coup d'etat in 1991. And her son was posthumously given the title of Hero of the Soviet Union. She was given an apartment as the mother of a hero. But the very first thing I asked her, when I asked her about today's Russia, the very first thing she mentioned was corruption. And it is the main issue. How the government will be able to get around this, I don't know. And by the way, President Putin launched his own website last week, and within an hour it was inundated with calls for him to withdraw from the presidency. Obviously from an organized opposition who know the internet, know information technology better than perhaps the Kremlin does. So what's going to happen? I think that Putin will be re-elected. But I think it's certain also that those who said Putin will continue in power for a further two terms, for 12 years, are now thinking again, and they're thinking again very seriously. He may retain power for one term. If, as Harold Wilson said, a week is a long time in politics, 6 years is a hell of a long time. Anything can happen in those 6 years. I think that Russia is going to be the most important news story internationally in 2012. Thank you very much.